Well, good morning to you. A very warm welcome to our live online service here at Revd Baptist Church today. I hope you're well. I hope you're keeping safe. And I hope you know that you are very welcome with us here this morning. A particular welcome to anyone who may be joining us for the first time today, whether you're just kind of exploring church from the safety of your sofa or whether you're perhaps visiting us from another church. It is great to have you here with us today. I don't know if you know this. This is a little statistic for you. We have now met together for more online services more times in 2020 than we have for services in our church building. Isn't that crazy? This is now the 13th week that we have been meeting online in this way, the 14th since the building was closed. And whilst we must absolutely make safety a priority in our decision making, we cannot wait to get back in the building together so that we can reverse that figure and get our live services back in the building. And I'm sure many of you at home will feel the same way. Of course, when we are in the church building, you don't have the luxury of some of the features that we have when we're online in this way. You can't turn on subtitles and you can't use the live chat function. Obviously, you can chat to one another in person, which is probably a much better solution when it comes to live chat. But you can use the live chat feature here on Teams today if you want to tell us who you are and where you're watching from. You can send in messages that others can see as well, send in messages of welcome. You can send in words of encouragement, prayer requests, whatever it is that you want to send in this morning. You can do that via the live chat. To access it, just click on the little question mark inside the speech bubble. It'll open the Q&A window. Ignore the fact it's Q&A. Just go ahead and click the ask the question button, the purple button you should see on the screen. Click that and you'll be able to type your message and send it into us for others to see. I also mentioned subtitles. If they would be helpful for you today, you can turn them on by clicking the settings icon in the bottom right-hand corner. For most people, you should be able to see that on the screen right now. It shows you what to do there. If you click the icon, you'll be able to change the caption settings, the subtitle settings from off to English. So do make use of both of those features if you'd like to this morning. Of course, they're only available to those who are watching live with us this morning. But of course, we extend our welcome to all of those who are joining us, whether catching up online at a later point or watching the service on DVD later in the week. We're going to welcome now those who are helping me to lead our online service today. I say welcome all of them. There's only two of them today. We're a little thin on the ground. Kim's having a bit of time off, so it's only Rob who is going to lead us in worship. Paul is back with us today. So let's go over to Rob. Say good morning to Rob.
Hi, Tom. Morning, everybody.
Good morning, Rob. How are you?
Very well, thank you. Yep.
Good. You're carrying us today, Rob.
Yes, but not, I'm not on my own, really, because I've got my trusty backing tracks from the gang with me. So
fantastic. Good. It's good to have you with us. And Paul, let's say hello to Paul, our church secretary.
Morning, Tom. Morning, everyone.
Morning, Paul. Are you well?
I am. Yeah. Good to be back with you after my week off.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. A bit of annual. You've been decorating, I believe, Paul.
That's right. Yeah, we were due to have been in Corfu this week. So decorating comes a bit of a distant second. But anyway,
well, I hear the temperatures are going to hot up this week. So maybe. Although you'll be back in work, never mind. I noticed, Paul, Tim in a moment is going to switch the camera back to me, and I'm slightly worried because it looks like we're wearing the same shirt. I've just noticed that. To go back to Paul again, people at home are going to see this. We seem to be wearing a very similar shirt. So I'm glad that you've decided that my style is a good thing to go for, Paul, on a Sunday morning, and you've joined me in the Czech shirt club.
I'm making no comment.
Yeah, good. It's good to have you with us. It's good to have them both with me here, of course, to lead our service this morning. It's good to have all of you at home joining us here as well. Today is, of course, Father's Day. It doesn't quite have the same historical connection to the church as Mothering Sunday or Mother's Day does. But I guess it seemed unfair at some point in history to be celebrating mothers and not have a chance to celebrate fathers. I suspect many fathers have done enough celebrating already with the return of the Premier League this week. Eight games, I think, have already been played, three more today. And if you didn't already know this, there are now 20 of the next 24 days. There are live matches somewhere on TV. But today, as we celebrate fathers and father figures, we want to thank them and bless them and pray for them. And of course, as we do that, we become even more aware of what it means for God to be a father to us. We are his children and he is our Heavenly Father. And so as we begin our worship today, we're actually going to start with a song that's all about the love of God the Father for each one of us. It's a new song to us. It's a song we've not sung on a Sunday morning before. And so we're actually going to use a video for this one. It's a pre-recorded video that we're going to share with you in a moment. Of course, if you know it and you want to sing along to it, then I encourage you to do that. I'm sure it'll be familiar to some of you. But if it's unfamiliar, then why don't you just sit and just listen, reflect as we come before our Heavenly Father this morning. Just allow the words to wash over you. You can read them, you can listen to them, you can sing them, reflect on them and what they mean for you today as we consider God our Heavenly Father. And so as we do, as we listen to this song, let us be drawn into God's presence this morning.
Stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whispers of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. I because you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Pray together, and I invite you to join me in the words that are marked in bold for all to say on the screen. Heavenly Father, on this Father's Day, it's an unparalleled joy to acknowledge you that you are the Father we've always longed for and needed. Thank you for adopting us through the finished work of Jesus. Thank you for freeing us from our slavery to sin and our orphan-like ways, and for giving us the spirit of sonship, a secure place in your family, and an inheritance that can never spoil or fade, kept in heaven for us. Thank you for promising to complete the work you began in us, and for always and only disciplining us in love, even when it hurts. Father God, we thank you for your perfect fathering. We praise you because we are fearfully and wonderfully made, shepherded and nurtured, disciplined and challenged, so we can flourish in your purpose and plan for us and bear our Father's image more fully. Father God, we thank you for your perfect example. We praise you because you show all fathers how to love, to shepherd and nurture, to discipline and challenge, so their sons and daughters can flourish in this world as you have planned and carry your presence to all they meet. Father God, we thank you for your perfect love. We praise you because you loved us before the world began. You came to us in Christ to die for us whilst we were still sinners, so that we might come to know the fullness of your love and share that love in word and deed in your world. Heavenly Father, we praise you, we love you, we thank you. Amen. So we're going to continue in our worship of our Heavenly Father as Rob leads us in a couple of songs together. Over to you, Rob.
Behold the man upon the
Deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. Thank you, Rob, for leading us in our worship this morning. As we continue to celebrate the theme of fathers, we're going to turn our attention to those fathers and father figures in our own lives who reflect the love and the care of our Heavenly Father towards us. Of course, we're mindful that not everyone will have been fortunate enough to grow up with a father or have had stable and loving father figures in their lives. Sadly, some may have been abused at the hands of their fathers or father figures. But while some may prefer to forget, others may be longing for answers to who their fathers even are. Some have lost fathers, others are new fathers. Some are desperate to be fathers. We all have different emotions on a day like today. And of course, that is made worse for many of us by the inability to see our family members in the same way during lockdown. Whatever your experience of fathers, fatherhood and father figures, we know that in our brokenness and humanity, we could never truly reflect the love of our Heavenly Father. But we thank God for his all-encompassing love for each and every one of us today. I'm going to watch a short video produced by Home for Good, which celebrates the role of fathers and father figures in our lives, but also helps us to reflect on all the different experiences that we will no doubt exist even within our own church community.
Thank you.
And so to all of those fathers, father figures, spiritual fathers, to those of us within our church community and beyond, we wish you a very happy Father's Day. Let's pray together. Father God, today we recognize you as our great and perfect Father who chose us for adoption into your family. How amazing it is that we should be called your children. Thank you for paying such a great price for us to know your perfect and enduring love for us. We're sorry for the times that we forget the truth of this and don't live as your cherished children. Today we thank you for and celebrate all the men who have helped us to know you better as a father through their role in our lives. We thank you for the men who have shown us your love, joy, and grace. We thank you for the men who have shown us your dedication and endurance through difficult times. We thank you for the men who have inspired us to be more like you. We thank you for the men who are part of caring for children in all sorts of ways, for those in schools, churches, and hospitals, health and social services. Today we come together as your children and we pray for each other. We pray for those in our family who have experienced pain and hurt through a father figure in their lives. We ask that you, our perfect parent, bring healing, restoration, and love to their lives today. And we pray for the children in our communities who need to know father and mother figures in their lives. Help us to respond to this need with the same welcome, acceptance and love that we have received from you. Amen. Amen. Now, for those who don't know, we actually have a father and son team right here in our live online services because our producer, Tim, working hard in the background to keep us on screen at home, is actually the son of our church secretary, Paul. So, Paul, we're going to come over to you for our news update, and I'm sure you're going to be able to tell us about all the wonderful Father's Day gifts that Tim has brought for you this year.
I've had a text to say he's going to drop it round later, so...
My presence not enough for you, you know?
Well, good morning all, and as usual, some updates about what's happening both within OB Baptist and also wider afield. First of all, many of you, I'm sure, will have seen Tom's email and indeed video message from earlier in the week regarding the continued closure of the church buildings. And in essence, the leadership team have agreed that at present the building will remain closed until such time that we believe it's safe to reopen without creating an unnecessary risk to those that are visiting it. The decision is going to be reviewed every fortnight, and information about how and when we will reopen will be circulated as soon as we're able to. So please do bear with us, and if you've got any questions or concerns in that respect, then please do contact Tom or any member of the leadership team. A reminder that this coming Wednesday, the 24th of June, we will be having our church meeting at 7:30, and members should have received an agenda and papers either via email or through the post. If you've not had those, then please do let me know. The meeting is going to be held via Zoom, and therefore, if anybody needs any help in how to connect to Zoom meeting, then again, please contact either Tom or myself by Tuesday, and we can arrange to help you with that. Weekly study group. So after a week's break, we're going to be starting up the usual Thursday evening study group again this coming Thursday at 7:30. Picking up the theme from today's service and continuing to look at Ephesians and transformed living. Tom will be sending out details of how to join that early in the week, and everybody's welcome to join us, whether or not you've joined previous sessions. So please do come along if you're able. A date to look out for, on Saturday the 4th of July, the leadership team are planning a prayer and retreat day. It's not going to be us all going off to one venue like we did when we went to Northampton previously, but it's going to be a time for the church family to set aside some time in prayer and discussion through online materials. And we want to commit to hearing God's will for the future ministry and mission for the church in light of the COVID-19 pandemic. So more information is going to be coming out on that shortly. So do put a date in your diary, because I'm sure that's filling up fast at the moment. We'll get more details out to you as soon as we know. Towards the end of this week, in fact, next Friday and Saturday, a group of men, quite apt for Father's Day, would have been heading off to a venue affectionately known as a field near Swindon for the gathering event, a weekend of camping, worship, teaching and outdoor fun. But sadly, like so many events this year, that has had to be cancelled. So there's no axe throwing, archery, barbecues or other manly pastimes to take place this year. The good news, however, is that the event or a number of materials from the event are being streamed online. So both this Friday and Saturday. So if you fancy some banter, some music, some comedy, coupled with some great teaching and worship, especially if you're not really into camping, then this is your opportunity. So do have a word with Graham or myself, or check out the email bulletin for links of how you can access that. Refreshments. So again, we're going to be joining together after this morning's service on Zoom for virtual refreshments. So details of how to join were on the same email as the details of this morning's service. So do let us know if you've got any problems in joining that. And finally, two celebrations this week to mention in our and finally slot, both concerning our recently wed. So Laura and Chris and Eden and Kieran have both moved into their first homes together. Not all four of them together, I would hasten to add. So both couples have been waiting for some time to move in, and with lockdown, that's obviously put things on hold. But we trust that both Laura and Chris in their new home in Enderby, and Eden and Kieran, who are now going to be living near to Abbey Park, are settling in well. I know Eden and Kieran have been having first world problems of getting their internet installed, but hopefully you'll soon be settling in and enjoying that next chapter of your lives together. So if you've got any and finally news to share, then please do let me know, and it would be great to share that with a wider church family. And with that, I'll hand back to you, Tom.
Brilliant. As always, thank you, Paul, for bringing us our OBC news update. Lots of information there, lots of things that Paul has shared with us for you to know about and be thinking about. Let me just reiterate again what Paul said about the church building. Hopefully, as he said, you will have seen the video that I shared this week. If you're part of the church family, it's there on our church website if you want to go and have a look at it. If it's in the COVID-19 section, there's a button on the homepage, or we can send you a transcript. So if you'd like a copy of the transcript, get in touch with Paul or I, and one of us will be able to send that over to you. We have made the decision to keep the building closed for now. We know that other churches are opening, and obviously more and more things in the community are beginning to open. It's great to hear the news that the alert level apparently is now dropped down to 3. It's great that the death rate, it's great that the infection rate continues to drop, but we just want to make sure we do everything we can safely and without any unnecessary risk. So for now, while we can't guarantee that safety and low risk environment, we are going to stay closed for the time being. It is something, as Paul says, we're going to review every fortnight, and we do hope that sometime soon we will indeed be in a position to open up the building within the guidelines of the government and the Baptist Union. Of course, as I shared earlier, this week. The great thing is that we're not limited in our prayer and our worship by being away from the building. And although things are obviously a little bit different and we miss people as we do this online, we still give thanks to God that we have access to him anywhere and everywhere, and that his church is not buildings, but it's people. It's you and I gathered in this way to still be the church that Christ is calling us to be. In fact, as we prepare our hearts and minds to hear from God's word, we're going to affirm our faith together in God as we sing together. And not only do we profess our faith in God the Father, but we also profess our faith in the communion of saints and in the Holy Church, not the buildings, but the body of Christ, which is something that we're going to be thinking about again in a few moments' time. Before we get there, let's sing together This I Believe.
Father everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty. Through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. Judge and our defender, suffered and crucified, forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious life, forever seated high. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus.
I believe in life eternal. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe.
Oh, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Rob. We're going to hear our reading for today, and Edwin, one of our young people at OBC, has recorded our reading for us.
But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he led captives in his train and gave gifts to men. Well, what does he ascended mean, except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. It was he who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers to prepare God's people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of men in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into him who is the head, that is Christ. From him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love, as each part does its work.
Great, thank you, Edwin. I wonder if you could just raise your hand for me if you or your family used to own a black and white TV. Now, of course, I can't actually see whether or not you have raised your hand, but I'm going to assume that some of you at home at least will have done so. You see, back before 4K Ultra HD curved OLED smart TVs, and back before the kind of massive amount of channels that you have access to even on Freeview, some of you will no doubt have watched BBC and ITV in black and white. Of course, they were the only two channels you could really watch back then. I wonder if anyone knows when the first colour broadcast was made in England. Again, if you've raised your hand, I can't actually see that. So I'm just going to tell you when it was. It was in the 1967 Wimbledon Championships, which I personally think is ironic because at Wimbledon, all the players have to wear white anyway. But there you go. That was the first TV colour broadcast. You know, I can't imagine what it must have been like to always watch TV in black and white. Sport must have been so boring. The grey team versus the slightly lighter grey team. And how would you have known about the golden buzzer on Britain's Got Talent? There's something, isn't there, about the vibrancy of colour that brings life. In fact, bringing colour to black and white photos is quite a popular thing right now. Ellie has a book here full of old photographs, black and white photographs that have been transformed with the addition of original colours. You can see some of them coming up on the screen now. It's like the black and white nature of the photograph suck the life out of the photo, but that life is now being injected back in with the use of colour. And I think that's something of what the Apostle Paul is talking about here in Ephesians 4, which Edwin read to us just a few moments ago. You see, as we continue in our series on transform living, a series that explores the second half of the book of Ephesians and which follows on from our previous series on the transform life, we hear Paul talk about unity and maturity through diversity. Unity is an issue really close to Paul's heart. And I'm actually going to go back a few verses before our reading today. I'm just going to fill in the gap between Chris preached on 4 verse 1 2 weeks ago. And our reading today was obviously from verse 7. So I'm just filling in the gap as well today. But all the way back in chapter 2, actually. All the way back to chapter 2, Paul talks of the unity that God has created. You might remember this from a few weeks ago, by reconciling Jew and Gentile into one new family in Christ. But now here in chapter 4, the emphasis has shifted. It shifted onto us, onto you and I. It is we that must make every effort to maintain, to keep the unity of the Spirit. Keeping unity is for Paul one of the key elements of transform living. And so let's unpack together this theme of unity and ask how indeed we might maintain it. Now the first thing you need to understand is why unity is important. And we'll come on to shortly some ideas of why it's good for the church, but more importantly than that, unity reflects the very nature of God. You know, Ellie and I, we spent whole terms, if not more, at Bible college studying the Trinity. And so there's no way I can do justice to Trinitarian theology in 30 seconds. But at the very core of our understanding of who God is, we believe, as we've just sung a few minutes ago, that he is one God, but three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You might have come across different illustrations to explain this. Maybe the idea of water being found in both ice, liquid, and steam. Or maybe the three-leaf clover, the shamrock, with one leaf, but it kind of has three very distinct parts. But the fact is, neither of these are adequate. These and other illustrations often focus on one being and lose the sense of three persons. Or they promote three persons in such a way that they become like three gods. But there is one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Father is not the Son. The Son is not the Spirit. The Spirit is not the Father. But all three are God. Not one third God, but all three are fully God. He's the perfect unity. He's the perichoretic unity, just throwing a theological term in there. And so if we want to reflect the very nature of God to the world, we need to learn what it means to be in such unity ourselves. Unity is important because it's how we show the truth about God to others. But that also means that unity belongs to him. Our unity is a reflection of his unity. He has established the standard for unity in creating one body in Christ. And that is why we are commanded here in Ephesians 4 to maintain unity. It already exists because of what God has done. But that is an invisible unity, right? It's a unity that exists in relationship within the spiritual body of Christ. We can't see that unity that Christ has created. So we're not called here to recreate the unity that Christ has created in himself. We're called to maintain that existing unity in a now visible way. in such a way that others outside the body, outside of the church, can actually see it. Now, I think when we begin to understand that Christ has created the unity in himself, and we begin to realize that what it means to maintain that unity, that is when we begin to understand the enormous responsibility of it all. And hence why, as Chris talked about 2 weeks ago, we are to live lives worthy of this calling. And that's the second point I want to make, because our lives do need to be worthy of this calling. We can't visibly maintain the invisible unity of God until we ourselves have figured out what it should look like in our own lives. This is from Ephesians 4, verses 2 and 3. It says, "Be humble and gentle, be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace." Humility, gentleness, patience, love, peace. Do they sound familiar to you? They should do if you're here with us last week for our all-age celebration, because they're some of the fruit of the Spirit that we looked at then, aren't they? And I think Paul is saying here that unity can only come when we get those sorted first. If we're arrogant, if we're quick to anger, if we're confrontational, if we're unforgiving, if we're lacking in grace, then there is no way we are going to be able to maintain unity with others. And so the first step then towards maintaining the visible unity of the body of Christ is to pray for the fruit of the Spirit in your own life. To pray for humility and gentleness, to pray for patience, peace, and love. So the basis of our invisible unity is God's very nature, three persons in one God. The foundations of our visible unity is our own relationship with God, evidenced by the work of Jesus in our lives through the Holy Spirit. But here's the thing, and this really is the crux of our passage and our theme for today. We are called to unity, not uniformity. We're called to unity, not uniformity. This is the third point that I want to make. Let's just go back for a moment to those images, those color transformations I mentioned before. You see, the problem with uniformity is that it can become bland and lifeless. Monochrome images, just shades of gray, they lack the same level of vibrancy and beauty and detail as their color images. Imagine you're putting together a child's jigsaw. Maybe it looks a little bit like this one on the screen. Maybe it's even more basic. Maybe it's just nine squares that sit side by side next to each other. And then compare that to the most impressive jigsaw you can think of. Here's one jigsaw. It's a 3D jigsaw where all the pieces are different shapes, they're different shades, they're different sizes and colours. A jigsaw where unity is established despite diversity and uniqueness. Well, now imagine a church where the same is true. This is what the late great English theologian John Stott says. He says, "Although there is only one body, one faith and one family, this unity is not to be misconstrued as a lifeless or colourless uniformity. We're not to imagine that every Christian is an exact replica of every other, as if we'd all been mass produced in some celestial factory. On the contrary, the unity of the church, far from being boringly monotonous, is exciting in its diversity. This is not just because of our different cultures, temperaments and personalities, but because of the different gifts which Christ distributes for the enrichment of our common life." That is the point Paul is making here in the first half of Ephesians 4, that our diversity is a key part of our unity. And in particular, Paul wants to say it is our diverse gifts that help us to maintain unity. Paul quotes in the passage we heard from Psalm 68, verse 18, "When he ascended, he gave gifts to his people." In Psalm 68, this is a reference to God conquering nations. He receives the plunder and the wealth as a tribute to himself. This is battle imagery. But here, Paul transforms it to speak of the crucifixion and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and how through defeating death itself, being raised to life again, Jesus has now given gifts to each and every one of us who belong to him. And, you know, I know we're always talking about this, aren't we? We're always talking about, you know, what's your gift? And so often I hear people say that they don't know, or worse, that they don't have one. Well, you do. If you belong to Christ, you have a gift from God. But here's the thing, not every gift is the same. In fact, I think we could say not every gift is equal. But every single gift is important for the proper functioning of the whole body. Let me read again from verses 11 through 13. So Christ gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, the teachers to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. You know, we make a really big mistake here when we believe that we must be one of those five gifted types of people. But we need to understand two things this morning. First, some of those gifts are obsolete now. Apostle was a term used to describe those who were witnesses to the resurrection. Nobody alive today, and indeed for the last, 1,940 years or so, is an apostle in that sense. And in the truest sense, neither is anyone a prophet, because prophets proclaim the word of God, which we now have in the Bible. But secondly, we need to look beyond these five giftings and we need to see what they're for. It's not that God gives us all gifts of evangelism or being pastors or teachers, but he gives those gifts to some so that in turn they can equip all his people for their own works of service so that the whole body may be built up. Because, you know, even the tiniest tendon is crucial for the fully functioning body. Paul points out that the mutual need and concern of different members of the body, every Christian equipped by God to play their part within the whole community, has a role in enabling the body to function as the complex and interdependent entity that it is. That's from theologian and commentator Tom Wright. Every member of the community has a role to play. Each and every one of you has a gift that God is using to grow his body, to grow the church until it reaches unity and maturity, attaining to the full measure of Christ himself. And that is a unity that stands shoulder to shoulder with diversity. You know, this is more than the idea of the priesthood of all believers. You might have heard this term before, but the priesthood is about access to God. We all have access to God. That's part of our Baptist theology and tradition. We all have access to God, and therefore we are all priests in that sense. But what Paul, I think, here is trying to get the Ephesians to understand, and I think it's a lesson we need to understand and take note of even today, is the importance of the ministry of all believers. Every Christian receiving from Christ a privileged ministry to others. Here is incontrovertible evidence, says John Stott, that the New Testament envisages ministry not as the prerogative of the clerical elite, but as the privileged calling of all the people of God. When every member takes seriously their gift and their role in ministry within the body, within the church, that is when the monochrome church becomes a vibrant and dynamic community of life and of colour. To me, it's like these marvellous pieces of architecture. There's got the Sagrada Familia, the Guggenheim Museum in Bilbao, the St. Basil's Cathedral in Russia. Amazing examples of diverse materials in various shapes and sizes, each with their own function, of course, within the structure, coming together to form the majestic and inspiring whole. It's by working together for unity, despite our diverse gifts, and of course, despite our diverse personalities and cultures and temperaments and more, that we inspire others as we point to the unity and the majesty of God. But perhaps more than that, we show the world how diversity works in unity. And isn't that what the world is crying out for right now? It's crying out for unity. It's crying out for freedom from oppression and injustice and prejudice. And I humbly suggest that for too long, the church has failed in its duty to show the world what diversity can look like in unity. We have failed to live the life worthy of our calling. We need to lament about that. We need to confess how we failed to witness to God's unity, that perfect unity that in turn points to God's love and his care for all creation. But here's the staggering thing. Despite our failures, despite our disunity at times, Jesus has chosen us to be part of his body. He's chosen us to be messengers of hope to the world. And so we need to show the world how it's done. The invisible reality of the barriers that Jesus has broken down, the barriers between Jew and Gentile, young and old, male and female, barriers of race, of gender, of age, of culture, of sexuality, of social class, and more. That invisible reality, which came to pass in the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, is what we need to witness to as a visible reality in the world. You know, the church cannot speak of the love of God unless it can witness to the unity of God. The church can't speak of the love of God unless it can witness to the unity of God. I genuinely believe that in these troubled times, these times of division caused by racial injustice, gender inequality, cultural bias, and let's not forget Brexit, we as the church have an opportunity to show the world a better way to live by modeling unity through our diversity. I genuinely believe that we are the hope of the world. And perhaps now more than ever, we need to take the opportunity that we have to witness to a broken, hurting, fractured, and needy world. And so as we come to a time of response, let us all consider the part that we have to play in the body of Christ, the gifts that we have been given to be used in service to the church so that we can all live a life worthy of the calling we have received. Let us grow in humility and gentleness, patience and love. Let us make every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit, speaking the truth in love, in order to grow to become the mature body of Jesus Christ, who is the head, building each other up in love as each one does the work to which they have been called to do. My prayer is that against the backdrop of brokenness and division, the church will rise up as a vibrant and life-giving beacon of hope, witnessing to the unity of God and the love of God for all people, and laying therefore the foundations for healing and restoration to take place until all things are brought together in Jesus on the last day. And so in response, we're going to sing together what is really a prayer. Great is the darkness that covers the earth, oppression and justice, injustice and shame. May now your church rise with power and love, this glorious gospel proclaim. Help us bring light to this world. Come, Lord Jesus, pour out your Spirit on us today. Let's sing together.
Great is the darkness that covers the earth. Oppression, injustice, and pain. Nations are slipping in hopeless despair. Though many have come in your name. Watching while sanity dies. Touched by the madness and lies. Come, Lord Jesus, come, Lord Jesus, pour out your spirit, we pray. Come, Lord Jesus, come, Lord Jesus, pour out your spirit on us today. May now your church rise with power and love. This glorious gospel will come to those who believe in your name. Help us bring light to this world, that we might speak your return. Lord Jesus, pour out your spirit, we pray. Come, Lord Jesus, come, Lord Jesus, pour out your spirit on us today. On that final day, when out of the heavens you come, darkness will vanish, all sorrow will end, and rulers will bow at your complete. And face to face we shall meet. Come, Lord Jesus, come, Lord Jesus, pour out your spirit.
Heavenly Father, we pray that you would send your spirit. Lord, help us to become the multicultural, multinational, multicolored church in every sense that you are calling us to be. Lord, help us to learn each day what it means to grow in our unity despite or through our diversity. Lord, help us to understand how we can use our gifts in service to you, how we can build up the body with the gifts and the skills that you have given to us. Lord, as we take a moment now to reflect, I pray that you'd speak to us. make clear to us, reveal to us the part that you are calling each of us to play, that we may indeed grow in unity and maturity into the full measure of Christ, that we become the body of which Christ is the head, showing the world how you have called us to live, your creation intentions reformed, restored back into the life and witness of the church. We pray, come Holy Spirit, come Holy Spirit, come Holy Spirit. Amen. I'm just going to put some slides up on the screen. They're going to be up for maybe a minute or so at a time. Different questions just for you to reflect on your own in the quietness. If you're with other people, if you're watching, you want to talk about it, that's fine. But I encourage you just to sit and just maybe reflect on your own and pray to God. What gifts has God given to you? And maybe you want to ask yourself, okay, what am I good at? What do I enjoy doing? What am I passionate about? What gifts has God given to you? Maybe just take that a little bit further and just ask the question, God, how can I use my gift to serve the body of Christ? Maybe just ask yourself, you know, what is it you could volunteer to do? What's stopping you from using your gift? Is there an opportunity that you're waiting for? Maybe there's something you just need to get up and do about it today. Maybe you need to get in touch with someone. Maybe you need to contact me or someone else about that gift you have and the way you want to use it. Just take a moment just to reflect. How can you use your gift to serve the church? And let's just spend a further time in prayer, just a few moments of quiet prayer. Pray for God to reveal, to grow your gifts. Pray for him to show you how you can use those gifts. But perhaps more importantly, pray for the church, the capital C church, but also our local church at OBC, to be united as the body so that we can witness to the love and the unity of God. Just take a few moments of quiet prayer to bring those requests before God. As we continue in our response to God's word, as we continue to consider our role in maintaining the unity of the Spirit within the body of Christ, and how we as the church, when united in love and purpose, can truly take the good news of Jesus into the world that so desperately needs to hear it. We're going to sing again. You might want to maybe take note of these and just keep praying them as we sing. You might want to join us in song. It's totally up to you, but we're going to sing together. O church, arise, hear the call of Christ our champion. Thank you, Rob. To love the captives of soul.
Church, arise and put your armor on. Hear the call of Christ our captain. For now the weak
say that they are strong in the strength that God has given, with shield of faith and belt of truth. We'll stand against the devil's lies, an army bold whose battle cry is love, reaching out to those in darkness. Our call to war, to love the captive soul, but to rage against the captor, and with a sword that makes the wounded whole, we will fight with faith and valor. When faced with trials on every side, we know the outcome is secure, and Christ will have the price for which he died, an inheritance of nations. Come see the cross where love and mercy meet, as the Son of God is stricken. Then see his foes lie crushed beneath his feet, for the conqueror has risen. And as the stone is rolled away, and Christ emerges from the grave, his victory march continues till the day, every eye and heart shall see him. So Spirit come, put strength in every stride, give grace for every hurdle, that we may run with faith to win the prize of a servant good and faithful. As saints of old still line the way, retelling triumphs of his grace, we hear the voice and hunger for day, when with Christ we stand in glory.
Amen. Thank you, Rob, for leading us in our response and in our worship today. Before Rob leads us in our final song, let me just remind you of a few things, if I may. Firstly, as Paul mentioned, if you want to dig deeper into some of the stuff we've been talking about today, come and join us on Thursday evening for our Transform Living Group at 7:30 for a 7:45 start on Zoom. You can join your laptop, your device, you can even just join on the telephone if you haven't got the internet. So however you want to join us, come and get in touch with me if you need the details for that. Remember, there's no Wednesday group, there's only the Thursday group. So do come and join us. Everyone is welcome there. The church meeting, of course, on Wednesday evening. Come and join us if you're a church member, 7:30 on Zoom. If you need any help or you haven't had the documents, again, get in touch with Paul or I. Of course, it's a bit of an experiment. We don't know if it's going to work. We don't know how well it will work. But we know that we want to give some time to discuss some of the things going on in the background of the life of the church, the children and family worker we've been discussing for a while. And of course, the church administrator role. So please do be there promptly at 7:30 if you intend to join us. I'm mentioning the church administrator. This is Steve Holman, our church administrator. It's his last official week in the church role this week. Obviously, he's not in the church office. He's working from home, but it's his last week as church administrator after 18 years in the role. We obviously want to find an appropriate time to thank him in person for all of his hard work and his dedication. But we owe him an enormous amount of thanks. And so we send our best wishes to him as he retires at the end of this week. Obviously, there might be a bit of a delay in emails as we kind of switch the system over. Steve won't be checking them. So bear with us. If you send the office an email, you don't get a reply. We will try and pick it up as soon as possible. And then lastly, do join us as we finish here over on Zoom. We'll be there for refreshments. The details have been sent out of our email to you. If you're not on our email list and you want to join us, please feel free to drop me an email. I'll send you the details and you can come and meet with us for refreshments in a few moments' time. But as we close, we're going to sing our final hymn. It's a hymn of commitment as we seek to take forward all that we've considered today and apply it to our own lives and the life of our church family. Be thou my vision. Thanks, Rob. Just pray together as we close our service. In the name of Christ, the one who makes us whole, and in the power of the Spirit who makes us one, we commit ourselves to lay our lives before the Lord of glory, and by his grace to serve him all our days. Lord, may the song of praise that we have offered in your presence be simply the overture of life, of a life lived for your glory. We've lifted up our hearts and voices in praise and adoration. Now, what we say and how we say it, what we do and how we do it, the lives we live and how we live them, our words of faith and our witness to Christ, lift the hearts and minds of all we meet to join in the song of praise to your glory. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, folks, for joining us today. We'll be here again next Sunday morning live at 10:30. But until then, may God bless you and keep you safe. May he make his face to shine upon you and give you his peace. And may you know his presence, his power and his promises each and every day. And may we all learn what it means to live in unity together for the praise of his glory. God bless. And we hope you'll be able to join us again soon.
Written home, so Every life I saw in